Okay, so we now have our project set up and we're ready to get started learning how Thymeleaf works. So to make a start, let's set up a controller to render a view. For this project, we're not going to have very much in the way of classes, so I'm not going to bother creating packages for controllers or services and so on. We'll just create a controller class in the default package. So we'll go into source main Java. Here's our default package. We'll do a new class. Well, I'm sure you know how to create a class that returns a view. I think we'll call it main controller. We need to annotate it with the @controller annotation. I'll just import that. And then in here, we need a method, which is going to return an object of type model and view. And we'll just call this home page. And for now, let's just return the view called home page with no actual model. Again, I hope all of this is straightforward and familiar to you. We're not doing anything particularly special here. We'll import model and view. And we need to annotate this method then with the request mapping, which we'll do with @requestMapping. And we'll allocate this the URL of the home page for our application, just /. Let's just import request mapping. Okay, so that's a really basic controller setup. If we run the application and try and visit localhost 8080, our application should try and display the view called home page. Now, at this point, not only have we not created the homepage view, we've also not yet configured the view resolver. We haven't told Spring whether we're using Thymeleaf, JSP, or some other technology for the view, and or whether to find the relevant view files in our project. But I'd like to run this anyway, visit localhost 8080, and let's see what happens. So to run the project, we'll open this Learning Thymeleaf application, and we'll choose Run As and Java application, and give that a minute to start. Okay, so let's open a browser. And here's localhost 8080, and as expected, we've got an error page with a status of 500. But let's have a look now at the stack trace in our application. We'll just maximize the console here. And here's the top of our stack trace. And what's particularly interesting, you might notice, is the exception type is org Thymeleaf exceptions template input exception. So the first thing to note here is that by having the Thymeleaf dependency in a Spring Boot application, it will automatically assume that you're going to be using Thymeleaf. We don't need to configure a template resolver. By default, Spring Boot will use Thymeleaf if it's in the dependency list. And not only do we not need to configure that Thymeleaf is our default templating engine now, if you worked with JSP, you probably ended up putting something in your application properties file that looked like this. You had to specify the location of your JSP files and your suffix, the fact that they're going to end in .jsp. Well, you don't need to do that for Thymeleaf. As long as you use the standard location for your Thymeleaf files, there is no configuration needed. I should perhaps say that if you have a traditional Spring MVC application, not a Spring Boot application, then you do need to do some configuration, but we will come back to that and have a look at how to do it a little later on in the course. So what are the default locations for our Thymeleaf files with a Spring Boot application? Well, before we find that out, I think this might be a good opportunity to introduce the documentation for Thymeleaf. I've got the URL for Thymeleaf on screen right now. It's www.thymeleaf.org, and you can follow the link at the top here called Docs to get to the documentation. Then you need to scroll down and make sure you get the section marked Thymeleaf plus Spring. Now, generally, I think the documentation is very good. It is pretty thorough and it's generally quite easy to read. But at the time of writing, not all of the documentation for Thymeleaf 3 is complete. And you may find you need to refer to the earlier version, Thymeleaf 2.1, to find the things that you're looking for. I'm going to be referencing the documentation a few times in this course. And when I do, I'm normally looking at the Thymeleaf 2.1. There has been very little difference between 2.1 and 3. At least everything in 2.1 is pretty much forward compatible. Now, if you look in here at how to configure Spring to work with Thymeleaf, all of the references in here are actually about Spring MVC. I haven't found anything in the documentation about Spring Boot. I guess that might be because Spring Boot doesn't really need any configuration. It all works out of the box. But amazingly, I haven't found anywhere on this site that documents the default location for your files. By the way, when you're looking through this document, they call the HTML files that you're going to create your Thymeleaf code in, the ones we're trying to find out where they're located, well, they call these the templates. So I'm going to start using that word from now on. Whenever I say let's create a template, I mean let's create an HTML file that we can embed Thymeleaf attributes in. So where do we put them? Well, without any configuration to say otherwise, the default location for the templates is source main resources and then a subfolder called templates. If you remember in the last chapter, when we configured the pom.xml, we said we wanted to include src main resources and any subfolders in our application. Now, Spring Boot has actually already created the templates folder for us, so we're going to be putting our HTML files in here. And in fact, any other files that our application needs, like CSS files, JavaScript or images, they're going to go in source main resources static into this folder. So using this knowledge, let's create our first HTML file, our first template. And for now, we'll just create a standard HTML file that displays the phrase hello world. So we'll go on to template, right click and choose a new, and it's going to be a new file. And we'll call this, well, I think as this is actually going to become our homepage, let's call it homepage.html. Now, by default, Eclipse has opened this file, the homepage.html, in the built-in browser. I'd like to make sure that all HTML files open in the standard Eclipse text editor, because we're going to be doing that a lot. So let's just close this. And then we want to go into Eclipse Preferences and choose this time General and Editors and File Associations. We'll then choose our HTML. And we want to remove the web browser and add in the default text editor, which, if we scroll down this list, is this one here, text editor. We'll click on OK and OK again. And now when we double click on our homepage.html, it opens as a file that we can just type into. OK, so let's create an HTML file. We'll start with the HTML tags. And then we'll need a body section. And in here, let's put in a paragraph, and within the paragraph, we can display the phrase hello world. Now, before you save this file, I hope you're following along with me, make sure that you have well-formed HTML here, that you have opening and closing tags for every tag that you're using, that you've used lowercase for all of your tags. That will do for now, and then we can save this. And as I've already said, we should be able to open this page in a standard web browser and see it. Right now it's standard HTML, so we definitely expect that should work. So to do that, let's go to our file system and we'll go into source main resources, then templates. Here's our homepage.html, and if I double click to open it on a browser, it's rendering fine. We can see the phrase hello world. And in fact, now if we go to localhost 8080, we get our hello world page rendered. So we've now shown that in our application, we don't need any configuration. As long as we've got Thymeleaf as one of our dependencies, we can create our files in the source main resources templates folder, and they'll automatically be found and automatically used from our controllers when we return a model and a view. Notice that the .html got appended automatically to our homepage. That's the default suffix for Thymeleaf. Okay, so we're ready then pretty much to start creating some valid Thymeleaf code. I call it code, but it's not really. It's actually a set of attributes to our HTML tags, as we'll see. But the first thing we need to do is to reference the Thymeleaf namespace in our HTML file. To do that, we need to change the HTML tag to include an XML namespace, and it looks like this. So we put in XML NS colon TH equals, and then in quotes, HTTP colon forward slash, and actually it's the URL of the Thymeleaf website, www.thymeleaf.org. So by putting that namespace in, it means that whenever we reference anything with a TH in front of it, it knows it's using the XML schema that's defined by this website. If you've worked with JSP, you'll know that you would normally now be putting tag libs at the top of the JSP page if you wanted to use any of the JSTL, the Java Standard Tag libraries. But with Thymeleaf, all we need is this one simple namespace declaration, nothing else. The good news is you won't be copying and pasting references to tag libs anymore. Before we go any further, and I want to cover this now because you may stumble across this problem very soon, and I want to ensure that you understand and know what to do about it, by default, Thymeleaf is very strict that the HTML it needs to work with must be XHTML compliant. Now, what this means is that the HTML you write must be parsable as XML. If you're not too familiar with this, don't worry. The important parts are about to become very apparent. Before I do anything, let's check we haven't broken our application by putting in this namespace. I'm going to make a little change, just put an exclamation mark here so that we know that our new version is being picked up. We'll save this and just refresh our web browser. Okay, good. So that's working. Now, I'd like to put in a BR tag, which is a blank line. So let's put that in here. And then after that, let's put in something else. I think we'll just put in another paragraph and the word goodbye. Very simple, very straightforward. And the important thing is that what we've got here is valid HTML. Let's save it and let's refresh the page. And we've now got an error. And that error is because although we had valid HTML, it's not valid XML. Now, if you get this error, you'll see it says there's an exception parsing the document. It does tell us where the exception occurred, which is line 6, column 3, but that isn't always accurate. And if we go into our code, here's line 6, column 3 is in the middle of the word body. This doesn't look right. Actually, it is accurate, but in order to understand why it's accurate, you need to understand what's really going on. When we created this BR, as far as XML is concerned, we're starting a new tag, and yet we haven't closed the BR tag. We're closing the body tag here, and yet BR is contained within body, so for this to be valid XML, it's expecting a slash BR before our slash body. That's why it's complaining at this particular point. Now, it can get quite difficult, therefore, to find which is the bit of HTML that's wrong, that's not valid XML, but you helpfully get a reasonable message in the stack trace. If I just maximize the console, and we'll scroll down to the last error, which is here, it actually tells us that the element type BR must be terminated by the matching end tag slash BR. So at least we get a very clear message in the stack trace. And actually, this is the important part. If you get an error message on your page saying it couldn't pass the document, have a look at the stack trace. It's likely to give you some more clues as to what's wrong, where your HTML is not well-formed XML. Okay, so we could fix this by making BR a self-closing tag by putting in the slash at the end there. I hope you're familiar with that construct. If we now go and refresh the page, it should work. And it does. Now, it may feel like I'm stressing this point, but it is very easy to make these mistakes. And actually, if you're taking an HTML file that a web designer has built for you, you might find that there is lots of well-formed HTML that's not valid well-formed XML. And in that case, you actually have two choices. You can go through putting in the closing tags, for example, to make it well-formed XML, or you can tell Thymeleaf that you don't want it to require your code to be valid XML, that it's to work with HTML only. Now, I actually don't recommend this. I think it's better to use valid XHTML, but I am going to show you how to make it work with standard HTML in case that's a requirement you have for your project. There are two things we need to do. The first thing is we need to set a value in our application properties file, and that is spring.thymeleaf.mode, and we set it equal to, all in capitals, legacy HTML5. The other thing we need to do is add an extra dependency into the Maven POM, and the dependency is on an HTML parser called NecoHTML. I've got a link to NecoHTML on screen here from NVN repository, and if we just pick the latest version, and then we can copy the dependency here to put that into our pom.xml file. And we'll paste that into pom.xml in the dependency section here. And we'll rerun this build then to get the dependency that we've added in. Before we do that, make sure that your application isn't running. Mine isn't, I just stopped it off camera. So as long as the application's not running, we can rerun this. So we'll run it as a Maven build. We'll choose the goal Eclipse. Okay, so that says it's built successfully. Now we're ready to rerun our application. So we need to refresh the project, of course, first. And then we'll choose run our Thymeleaf application. And we'll go to the browser as soon as that's finished and refresh our localhost 8080. And it's working again. And just to prove the point, if I go to homepage.html, I think I might have done that off camera, my BR tag is not well formed. So that is an option. As I say, I prefer not to do that. So in this, I'm going to comment out the Spring Thymeleaf mode is legacy HTML5. I'll leave it here commented out so that if you do need it, it's in the closing workspace for this chapter. But I prefer to use strict HTML. If we save this now, we'll just wait for our application to restart, and hopefully we'll get that error again to tell us that our HTML is not well formed. We'll just fix that by putting in the backslash at the end of our BR tag and make sure that's working again. Okay, so we've actually done quite a bit in this chapter, and we've not even really started on Thymeleaf yet, but there is just one final thing I want to do before we move on, and that is that if we're going to be producing well-formed XHTML files, then we really should have a doc type at the top of the HTML page. I'll leave you to read up on what the doc type declaration is for, but let's insert it so that we have a very good basic XHTML file. So at the top of our page, I'm going to put in exclamation and then all in capitals, doctype HTML. And that one doesn't need a closing tab. Okay, so we're finally ready then to start learning about the Thymeleaf attributes. We will be doing that, I promise, in the next chapter. I'll see you there.